and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lowly exile here until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night until the shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. And fourth is the last. O come, desire of nations, bind all peoples in one heart and mind. Bid envy, strife, and quarrel cease. Fill all the world with heaven's peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Sing this together. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee, Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth. Thou art dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever. Now thy gracious kingdom reign by thine own eternal spirit, ruling all our hearts alone by thine all-sufficient merit. Raise us to thy glorious throne by thine own eternal spirit, ruling all our hearts alone by thine all-sufficient merit. Raise us to thy glorious throne.
Let's pray together. Father, this morning, we are so thankful for this Advent season where we can celebrate you coming to ransom mankind and to redeem us unto yourself. As we spend some time in the Word and in song this morning, we just ask that you would bless each one here, that our hearts would be encouraged and drawn closer to you. And we just ask you to just work this morning in this place. In Christ's name, amen. Sing a couple more together. It is the Christmas season, so I got to squeeze as many of these things in as I can. We're going to go ahead and sing Ring the Bells. We learned this. We didn't sing it last year, but we learned it the year before. So we'll go ahead and sing this together. Ring the Bells on this Christmas morn. Familiar one, God rest ye merry gentlemen. God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. From God our Heavenly Father, the blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same. How that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy,
comfort and joy. Oh,
tidings of comfort and joy. Now to the Lord sing praises, all you within this place, and with true love and brotherhood each other now embrace. This holy tide of Christmas of love is
deeming grace.
Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Amen. You can be seated. I think I'm feeling a little dyslexic back here, Darren. I was having a hard time reading those this morning. Well, I just have a handful of announcements this morning, and then we will be ministered to in special music by Kristen. We're looking forward to that. The first thing I need to do, and I meant to do this last week, and I need to apologize to Dot, because I've had this sticky note up here for 2 weeks now. A couple weeks ago, I said that Rick and Dot were the ones who set up all of the Christmas decorations. And while that is partially true, they actually had quite the crew helping them out, and I was asked to make sure that everybody got a little bit of recognition for the incredible job that they did. So not only was it Rick and Dot, but Barbie helped, Paige and Lauren, Diane, Marilyn, Crystal, and Ethel. So thank you guys so much for all of the effort that you put in every year to really make this place feel like home for the holidays. So we're just so thankful for this time. I do also want to make mention to the poinsettias here this morning. Sharon Campbell, or not Sharon, these are in memory of Doug Campbell, dropped off. So we just want to, I was thinking Sharon Wade, but it's my bad. Okay, so Doug and Donna, so these are in memory of Doug, so just want to just let everybody know about that. I have a handful of cards to read this morning. The first is from the McGilchrist family, to Parker's Cove Baptist Church. It's easy to say thank you, but it's harder to convey the heartfelt gratitude felt today. Your thoughtfulness means more than words can ever say. Thank you for your phone calls, cards, gifts, visits, and prayers during this difficult time, Scotty and the family. So do keep them in your thoughts this Christmas season. And these cards will all be posted out on the bulletin as well if you want to take a chance to read those yourselves. And this one is actually a little bit of a Christmas greetings and a little bit of an update from Grant and Elizabeth Fawcett. Dear friends at Parker's Cove Baptist Church, thank you for your prayers and support over the past year. We have been very blessed by your part in the ministry here at Arrowhead. Thank you. Wishing each of you a very Merry Christmas. May you find hope, peace, and joy in Jesus Christ as only he can give. Merry Christmas, Grant and Elizabeth Fawcett and the girls. As far as regular weekly announcements, the only thing I have to remind folks of is our Christmas Eve service coming up on December 24th. We're going to have a good old-fashioned Parker's Cove family Christmas. It's going to be at 6 p.m. We'll try to keep it to an hour, and we just want to invite all of you to come on out. We look forward to spending some time reading the Christmas story together and also looking into some of these familiar carols that we love so much. And a really quick announcement, following the service this morning, last week we had Curtis and Leona Duclos sharing their testimony. The Deacon Board has recommended them for membership, so we do ask that all members after the service, if you could stay back for about 5 minutes, we're just going to have our quick vote, and then, Lord willing, extend to them the right hand of fellowship. So if you're a member and you have a few extra minutes, please be here so that we can have that vote. We're really looking forward to having them join our family here. We're so, so thankful for just everything that they're going to bring to the table. So we're looking forward to that and just ask that you would stay for that as well. I believe that's all that I have for announcements. Am I forgetting anything? I do have one more announcement. Jeff, I am so sorry. I wrote it down. I'm telling you, my reading skills this morning. The sermon's going to be rough, guys. I can't read today. So buckle up. No. Judy Baker's graveside service is going to be tomorrow at 11 a.m. So we just want to let the family, the church family here, know about that. Jeff will be looking after that. So I think that's all that I have. Thanks, Jeff. Really sorry. This time I'll invite Kristen up.
She invited her mom to help. There used to be a time she didn't invite me, but anyway, it's all good. Sorry.
The bells, they're ringing loud and clear. You can't help but love this time of year. Christmas time, there's something in the air. There's a little bit of heaven everywhere. Ooh. Somehow there's a little more of love. Maybe there's a little less of us. Maybe we're just slightly more. There's a little
Thank you, Kristen and Marilyn and Caroline.
That was really sweet.
As we look into the Word this morning, we'll be discussing the second gift of the wise men, the gift of frankincense, and we're going to discuss all that that means. But one of the key points this morning is how Christ is our intercessor. He is our mediator. He is the one who goes on behalf of us to God the Father and pleads our case. And what better song to sum that up than this song, "In Christ Alone My Hope Is Found Through the Fiercest Drought and Storm. He is my comforter, my all in all, and here in the love of Christ I'll stand." So let's go ahead and stand together as we sing "In Christ Alone."
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still. Striving cease, my comforter, my all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. Scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was the ground his body lay, the light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. Adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh,
for singing with us this morning. And at this time, I'll go ahead and dismiss our young ones down for junior church.
Make sure I turn this thing on. Well, if you have your Bibles this morning, I'll invite you to turn to Matthew chapter 2. And we'll begin by looking at our home-based passage, as I'm going to call it, over the next couple of weeks. It's where we started last week. Matthew chapter 2, and our main passage being verses 1 through 11, but I'm just going to read verses 10 and 11 this morning. When they, the wise men, the magi, saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So last week, we began our study on the gifts of the wise men here in Matthew chapter 1, or Matthew chapter 2. Just to recap really quickly what we talked about last week, we learned that the wise men were known as the Magi. They were a group of astrologer priests from ancient Persia. They were known as kingmakers, counselors, mystics. They were well-versed in prophecy, and because of that, they were very intent on finding the one who would be born, the Messiah, or as they called him, the King of the Jews. And they sought the newborn Christ to worship him and to present him with gifts. And we began setting up our series last week discussing the fact that each one of these gifts actually highlights a special characteristic about who Jesus Christ is and who the Messiah was meant to be. And last week we discussed their gift of gold, pointing to the fact that Christ came to be the King of Kings. And this morning, we're going to be looking at the second of those gifts from the Magi, the gift of frankincense. But before we dig too deep into this passage, let's just take some time to look to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we are just so mindful of just the privilege that we have to be able to look into your word this morning. We just thank you for it. We thank you for what it has for us. Father, as we look into the character of Christ this morning, we just ask that you would be honored and glorified in our conversation, that this would just point us all to you, that you would be praised and lifted high. Father, I ask that my words would be few, that you would speak this morning, and we just look forward to being here together as family, studying your precious word. And Father, for those who are not able to be here with us this morning, we do continue to pray your hand on the many families who are not able to be here. We just thank you so much for them. We ask your blessing on their lives. We thank you for the gift of modern technology that allows us to be able to still minister to so many who aren't able to be here in this building. And we just ask that you would continue to use the work of this ministry to be an encouragement to those, both here on the shore, but also in the greater area. We just ask that you would work this Christmas season in such a way that would be so evident that we could just point to your love for mankind and just be so blessed by who you are and all that you do for us. And we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. So this morning, we are going to be looking at this gift of frankincense. And the first question, obviously, to ask is, what is frankincense? My dad sent this to me last night, and I couldn't not put it in. I don't know about you guys, but growing up as a kid, frankincense and Frankenstein were the exact same thing. I'm sure at one point or another, all of us has probably made that mistake once or twice, but my dad sent that to me last night, and I was like, we got to throw that in. That's hilarious. So obviously, you have the three wise men. We got the gold and the myrrh, but what on earth is that? Well, what is frankincense? It's a bit of a weird word. What is it? When we look at the Christmas story, when we look at these gifts, I think so much, just like a lot of the carols or the familiar Christmas stories, we kind of get caught up in simply the reciting of these things. We know that the gifts were gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and we just kind of leave it at that, just like we know that there was the shepherds and the angels, and we talk about all these things almost to a detriment, the same way that we know the story of Ebenezer Scrooge. We know all of the different aspects of it. We know maybe Charles Dickens' books, or perhaps if you're a real scholarly individual, your favorite version is the correct version, which is the Muppets Christmas Carol. But So there's all of these things about the Christmas story that we know and that we love, but how often do we actually really dig deep and try to understand what these things are? Well, this morning we want to look at this gift of frankincense, so let's just figure out what on earth it is to begin with. So frankincense is actually, it's a hardened gum-like material, also known as a resin, that comes from the Boswellia tree. Now, the Boswellia tree, there's this whole breed of trees that go under this genus, and they grow all over the Middle East. But during the times here in the ancient Middle East, it was actually harvested from a very specific breed of this tree that grew predominantly in the Arabian Peninsula. So because it was harvested from a very specific tree that only grew in one location, it made it a very rare and valuable substance. Frankincense, I could probably best describe it as having a bit of a woody or a spicy scent to it. Not spicy as in hot, but the smell of spices. And it has a very wood-like scent. It's very unique, and frankly, it's quite pleasant. You can buy frankincense today. Generally, the stuff that you'll buy in the store is actually sourced from Africa. There's another well-known breed of the Boswellia tree that grows there in the Horn of Africa, and that is much easier to come by, and it's a lot more cost-effective. So when you go to Walmart or wherever it is, and you're looking at your essential oils packets, 9 times out of 10, when you're buying frankincense, you're buying something from Africa or some other region within the Middle East. But the frankincense that we're talking about here was a very limited supply that was grown in the Arabian Peninsula in Saudi Arabia. It was predominantly used by the Levitical priesthood as an incense that was to be burned as an offering to God, as prescribed in Exodus chapter 30, verses 34 through 38. So I'll save you guys the time, and I'll scoot right on over there for you. In Exodus chapter 30, as God through Moses is declaring what the order of the priesthood should look like, how their worship should be laid out, he gives very specific instructions here in verse 34, and it says this: "And the Lord said to Moses, take sweet spices, stacked onycha and galbanum, and pure frankincense. And with these sweet spices there shall be an equal amount of each. And you shall make these an incense, a compound according to the art of the perfumer, salted, pure, and holy. And you shall beat some of it very fine, and put some before the testimony in the tabernacle of meeting, where I will meet with you. It shall be most holy to you. But as for the incense which you shall make, you shall not make any for yourselves according to its composition." And that's a very important thing to notice. This recipe for the incense that God required of Israel was specifically for him. It wasn't meant to be offered to anybody else. It wasn't meant to be used as a personal perfume, but rather it was specifically for worshiping God. And he says, "It shall be to you holy," or set apart before the Lord. "Whoever makes any like it to smell it, he shall be cut off from his people." That's a pretty serious indictment. But God was very specific in how he desired for the children of Israel to honor and to worship him. So frankincense, as we understand now, is it was burnt as incense. It was sometimes used in a powder that was laid before the testimony of the tabernacle. And it was predominantly used by the Levitical priesthood in the worship of God. But believe it or not, frankincense was also something that the Magi were very, very knowledgeable about, because they also used it in their religious structure of Zoroastrianism. They used it to present it as incense to their false gods, and also used it in the forms or in the ceremonies of coronation. It was a very, very valuable and expensive and revered spice. So when we look at this gift of frankincense, understanding a little bit better of what it is and what its origins was and what it was used for, as we look at this given to a child, because let's think about it, who's really going to give something so expensive and so considered to be sacred to a small child, but when we look at what frankincense is, we actually see two things about Christ's character in this gift of frankincense to him. There's two important aspects of the Messiah that we see here. The first, because of frankincense's history as a gift reserved only for God, by presenting it to Christ, the Magi are affirming his deity, his divinity. They are saying to this child, this gift that is reserved for God, we give to you, recognizing who you are. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more in a minute. We're going to unpack what that looks like to recognize Christ's divinity. And second, because of its exclusive use within the Levitical priesthood, the presentation of frankincense to Jesus also shows us, and it represents his priesthood, which we learn about in Hebrews as being a greater priesthood, not simply what was set up in the Old Testament, but something that was meant to be far greater, an eternal and holy priesthood. So this morning, we're just going to look at these two things, Christ's divinity and Christ's priesthood, as we seek to appreciate him even more this Advent season. So the first thing we're going to look at, obviously, is Christ's divinity. And here's the thing, the deity of Christ is something that simply can't be ignored. It is literally the crux of our faith. If Jesus is not who he says he is, then our faith is in vain. Then our faith is completely hopeless. We are left without security, we are left without eternity, and we are left without hope. Now, there are those today who simply like to claim that Jesus was a great teacher, or perhaps a morally excellent man who did a lot of good for mankind. But certainly he couldn't have been God. He couldn't have been the Son of God. There are even those who falsely claim that Jesus never claimed to be God. But there are a number of accounts in Scripture where Jesus claims his deity. When we read through the book of John, yeah, I'd really encourage you guys to do a study on the seven I am statements. Each of these statements that Jesus declares about himself begins with the phrase, I am. I am the bread of life. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the light of the world. When we look at these I am statements of Christ, he is very clearly using this phrase, I am, to remind the Jewish people of their history, to remind them of the name of God that they hold so reverently, as we see in Exodus chapter 3. This name for God that we have come to call Jehovah. So Jesus claims deity multiple times in his earthly ministry. In John 8:58, he says, before Abraham was, I am. He is claiming eternal existence in deity. He says, if you know me, you know the Father, because I and the Father are one. So as we study Christ's teachings and his multiple claims of divinity, there's only three conclusions that we can come to. There's only three ways that you can look at it. If you're going to claim that Jesus was simply a good teacher, well, he claimed to be God, so he must have been insane. So therefore, you have to rule out that he was just a good teacher. Because what kind of good teacher goes around calling himself God? Who wants to listen to somebody who calls themselves God and consider that to be a good teacher? By today's standards, they would probably lock him in a loony bin. Two, the other conclusion we can come to is that he was a liar. So he may have been a good teacher, but his claims to divinity were clearly false, and he was lying to the nations. Well, in which case, we can't see him as a morally excellent man. So the only right and rational conclusion to come to when we study the life of Christ is that he is who he says he is. He is who the Scriptures say he is. He is the eternal Son, the second member of the Godhead. And the importance of recognizing this and holding to it simply cannot be overstated. We have to recognize that we serve Jesus, the Son of God, who as a member of the Godhead is equal with God. I'll give you a little bit of a history lesson this morning. Because this idea of Christ's deity is actually something that unfortunately has been debated for centuries. Even as early back as 325 AD, at the Council of Nicaea, there were bishops, elders, and church leaders from across the known world who gathered together to discuss and affirm many of the pillar faiths of Christianity. And among these men was a bishop by the name of Arius. And Arius taught a teaching that would later become known as Arianism, which claimed that Jesus was not divine because he was a separate creation of God. He was not eternally existent. He was not the second member of the Godhead, but rather was a being created separately from God at the nativity to bear the sins of mankind, but not to be equal with God. Well, this teaching, known as Arianism, was argued against vehemently at this council. It was labeled heresy, as it rightly is, because it denied Christ of his divinity. And tradition tells us that there was one such bishop in attendance here, a man by the name of Nicholas of Myra, and he could not continue to hear the slander of Christ and these attacks against the divinity of Christ. And he argued heatedly with Arius. And when Arius would not stop proclaiming this false teaching, Nicholas approached him, and I know it looks like he's giving a gentle touch on the side of the face, but he actually struck him across the face. He struck him, silencing Arius in front of the entire Council of Nicaea. Bless you. Goodness me. That was me yesterday. Whew. So this bishop, Nicholas, was so infuriated in his heart that somebody would claim that Christ was not God, that Christ was not divine, that it drove him to, out of obviously sinful anger, to strike Arius across the face, silencing him in front of the whole council. So, you're probably wondering, what on earth does this have to do with Christmas? Well, we're going to get to that, because this is the really cool part. You see, Nicholas of Myra was initially made famous for punching out Arius at the Council of Nicaea, but eventually would become known for his charitable deeds and the love of Christ that he showed to so many. And after many, many, many years, he would receive a new name, Jolly Old Saint Nicholas. Believe it or not, before Santa was famous for giving out presents, he was famous for laying out heretics. And if that doesn't light your fire, your wood's wet. So that's why I wore my Santa Claus tie this morning. Because the most important thing on Santa's list is to recognize that Jesus Christ is God. That Jesus Christ is the eternally existent God of the universe. And is deserving of our honor, of our worship, of our fear, and of our love. In John chapter 1, verse 1, we read this. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things that were made through him, and nothing without him was made that has been made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. This word, logos in the Greek, refers to Jesus Christ, the expressed thought of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. When it comes to studying the theology of Trinitarianism, it's safe to say that we'll never fully be able to wrap our minds around it, but what we do know without a shadow of a doubt is that Jesus Christ is God, and his divinity cannot be ignored, and the wise men knew that when they presented him with this gift of frankincense. He is the creator, the sustainer, and our source of life. So that's the first thing that we need to realize this Advent season is we're not just celebrating God sending his son, but God coming down to man. That's why we sing, O come Emmanuel, God with us. One last thought. If you want to argue the divinity of Christ, you're more than welcome to. Be careful, because you might end up with a right hook instead of coal in your stocking this year. So we have Christ's divinity. Second, we have Christ's priesthood. And for this, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to invite you to turn to Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. A lot could be said this morning about the priesthood of Christ. I would love to do an entire series on it. The book of Hebrews so beautifully illustrates why Christ's priesthood is so much greater than that of the Old Testament Levitical priesthood, but we would be here for a month of Sundays if I did that. So this morning, in the time that I have left, I just want to lay out just a few truths from this passage. But let's read it together. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Jesus Christ is the eternal high priest. This word priest, when we look at the Hebrew and in the Greek, the word priest means priest. But when we break it down a little bit more and we look at the Latin root of priest, it means mediator or intercessor. Priest in Latin, the root is pontifex, which literally means bridge maker or bridge builder. The Old Testament Levitical priesthood was set up for the sons of Aaron to act as bridge builders between the children of Israel and God. You sneezed on me, now I'm coughing. I'm kidding. Nobody panic. So the Levitical priesthood was set up for Aaron and his sons to be the bridge builders between God and his people. They represented the people, they made sacrifice on behalf of the sins of the people, and they led the people of Israel in worship of God. But Christ's priesthood is so much greater than this, because while the Levites were responsible for building a bridge between Israel and God, Christ is the eternal high priest who made a bridge between all of mankind in the Father. The most beautiful bridge ever made took two pieces of wood and three nails. And Jesus Christ stretched out his arms and offered himself as the way between God and man. And today, he acts as our high priest who is constantly mediating on our behalf, making intercession on behalf of all believers constantly at the right hand of God. Something to notice in verse 14, or verse 15, or no, for, verse 14, sorry about this. It's that dyslexia again. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. Something to notice in this verse is that it says that Christ passed through the heavens, just like Aaron on the Day of Atonement would pass through the veil into the Holy of Holies to offer the blood of a lamb as atonement. Christ shed blood on the cross was atonement for all the sins of man. And when Christ passed through the heavens directly into the presence of God, he began and is now continuously interceding on our behalf. Because of who Jesus is as our great high priest, we should hold firm to our confession of faith as we read in verse 14. In verse 15 says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but in all points was tempted as we are, yet without sin. You see, in the Old Testament priesthood, the Levites were a specific tribe that was consecrated and holy and set apart to be the sole mediators between Israel and God. They were from the people, but they were meant to be consecrated and separate from the people. The high priest's role was to commune with God and make intercession on behalf of the people, but he himself was to be set apart. He wasn't able to sympathize with the day-to-day of the rest of the children of Israel. But Christ is not a priest who cannot sympathize with our struggles, because Christ, in his infinite love and holiness, came down at the incarnation, at the nativity, became a man, and because of this, knows every struggle that we can deal with. It says we do not have a priest who cannot sympathize, but one who in all points was tempted as we are, yet without sin. We know from Matthew's account, when Jesus went into the wilderness for 40 days and was tempted by the devil, there are those who claim, make the argument, that because of Jesus' inability to sin, he could not have possibly been tempted as we are tempted. There's no way that he could have actually experienced temptation if he was incapable of sinning. And while that's true, that he was incapable of sinning, we call this the impeccability of the Son, he did have weaknesses. This word weaknesses in the Greek is asthenai. And this refers to weaknesses common to our human nature. When Satan came to tempt Christ, the first thing that he says, if you're the Son of God, turn these stones to bread. He preyed on the human weakness of Christ. So Jesus is able to sympathize with our weakness, whether it's hunger, thirst, weariness, love, a sense of rejection, sadness. Jesus was fully human and fully God. We've been talking about this idea in our youth Bible study, and I won't put anybody on the spot, but I taught our teens a really big word. It starts with an H. It's called the hypostatic union. The hypostatic union refers to the fact that Jesus was fully God and fully man, not half of one and half of the other, but fully God and man. And as such, in Christ's humanity, he knew exactly what it meant to be tired, to be lonely, to feel loss, to be hungry, to thirst. And yet, in all these things, he was the God who could do something about it. What do we read when we look at John chapter 11? The death of Lazarus, one of Christ's closest friends. In that moment, we see in Christ's humanity the sorrow of the loss of his close friend, but then in that exact moment, we see him as the resurrection and the life, the God who can do something about that circumstance. And that's why we can have such hope in Christ as our priest, because he can relate to us. He's not some far-off, distant God who simply put the world into motion and then step back and let it do its thing. He is intimately involved and desires to be intimately involved in your life because he can understand where you are regardless of your struggles. No one knows them better than Christ. As we look at verse 16, it says, let us therefore, as Jeff always says, if there's a therefore, what's it there for? Because of all of these things, because of the fact that Christ is our high priest who loves us and who relates to us, because of this, let us come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let's break this down. Let us come boldly with confidence, with freedom of speech, recognizing that God wants to hear from us. What is it that Peter says? Cast your cares upon him, for he cares for you. So boldly, let us come, let us draw near, let us approach closely to the throne of grace. Not cower away, but come directly to the feet of our Savior. Let us come to the throne of grace. God's throne is a place where we find grace through the mediation of our high priest at the right hand of God, that we may obtain mercy, compassion. Interestingly enough, this word for compassion translates with the idea of empathy, of fellow understanding, which further supports what we just talked about in verse 15, that Christ understands, that he can sympathize, that he can empathize with our situation, and when we come to him, we can come boldly knowing that he has our best interests at heart. And only he knows what those best interests are. And we find grace, we find rest, the continuing rest and peace that is only found through daily submission to Christ. And we find it in time of need. In the Greek, this isn't talking about a specific time. This is talking about whenever we need it. We have continual, unimpeded access to the throne of grace because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. The children of Israel, they had the priesthood who on certain days and on certain months, and there was the one day of the year, the Day of Atonement, but there was a schedule that had to be followed. The people of Israel did not have direct access to God. They had to go through the priesthood. But because of Christ's finished work on the cross, because he is both God and mediator, we have 24/7 unimpeded access to our Heavenly Father. Whenever we are struggling, whenever we are not struggling, we have access to the God who loves and the God who seeks for us to be conformed to his image. So when we look at Christ's deity, we see the power over creation. We see his plan of redemption for mankind. And when we see Christ's priesthood, we see his intimate desire to be involved in our lives. So we have this gift of frankincense. It's a funny word, a seemingly insignificant oil, a fragrance. Like we said at the beginning, who gives incense to a baby? It doesn't make any sense. But when we study it out, when we look at the whole counsel of God's revealed word, we understand that there is such a significance to this gift. In the layout of Matthew, in his writing of this account, it's important to keep in mind that there is structure within Jewish literature that sometimes we don't fully understand. Thank you. When we look at this, there is a reason that Matthew ends with these gifts. The thing that is last mentioned in an account within Jewish literature is normally that of prime importance, of prime understanding. So as Matthew is writing, he puts in this detail that they worshipped the child and that they gave him these gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold for the King of Kings. Frankincense for our God and our priest. This teaches us two things about our Savior. It teaches us of his eternal power, his holiness, his omnipotence, but it shows us his vested interest in our lives as our high priest, the one that we can go to at any time, the one that we can find comfort and mercy and compassion and rest. He is our King, he is our God, and he is our priest this morning. So as we go out this week, as we continue to celebrate this Advent season, as we continue to get excited about the 25th coming up and the time that we'll have with family and friends, let's remember that this is a time to celebrate God's infinite love for humanity. Let's pray. Father, this morning we thank you so much for your love for us, in spite of us. Father, I am a broken, sinful individual, but yet you love me. God, we thank you for your compassion, for your grace. But Father, we recognize your holiness and your justice. And we just thank you so much that through the work of your Son, you have spared us from the eternal punishment that we so deserve. We thank you for your grace and for your mercy. And this morning, we worship you as our God. We look to you as our priest, and we submit to you as our King. I just pray for your blessing on each one here. I ask that as they go out, that you would just work through their lives in a new and a fresh way this week. Help them all to recognize your presence. And Father, just thank you so much for this time that we have as family, and we look forward to being together again next week. In Christ's name, amen. Thank you all for being here. Just a reminder to our membership, we are going to be meeting in just a few minutes to vote on Curtis and Leona. So I'll give everybody a few minutes for those who aren't going to be staying for that meeting to make your way out. But thank you all for coming. We'll see you next week.